Johnjoe explained very clearly that there's a trivial sense in which quantum mechanics is essential for biology, inasmuch as it explains chemical bonding, the sizes, shapes, and affinities of molecules. But I think the title Quantum Biology refers to something that goes beyond that, something non-trivial, and we have a long list of what I would consider non-trivial quantum effects, such as tunneling and entanglement and coherence and things involving the Pauli principle. And so I think we'd all like to know whether those non-trivial effects play a role in biology. So to get started, I've listed five different ways in which we could, or opinions that we could have about that. First of all is the one that Johnjoe already covered, which is that all biology can be understood with ball and stick concepts. That seems to be good for most biologists. They are either shocked by the idea of quantum biology or they don't understand it. It may be that quantum mechanics as such has very little to say about life, but quantum-inspired concepts may apply. That is, that we can draw insights from our understanding of quantum mechanics and apply them in a non-quantum manner to biological systems. I think Sandu Popescu has some ideas along those lines, and Lloyd Demetrius as well. Then we come on, and we might say that we have quantum effects that occur here and there, but they don't matter much. That they, if you could look in enough detail, you would see that they're needed, that we need to invoke quantum mechanics to explain them, but that they don't actually make much of a difference the way life operates. I think we probably, everybody here would be more in this camp, that there are at least some truly important, literally vital processes in biology that cannot be understood without quantum mechanics. That was Schrodinger's dream, that quantum mechanics would somehow explain the mystery of life. It had sufficient weirdness and sufficient power to explain the mystery of matter, now it was going to explain the mystery of life. And that's the dream, and it's sort of struggling to get out. It's, we here get tantalizing glimpses that this may be the case, but so far nothing definitive. And then we could go beyond that, and this intrigues me, and we must not lose sight of the fact that quantum mechanics may not be the final answer, that is, a true description of the nature of the world may require some post-quantum mechanics, which might be even weirder than quantum mechanics, and might have yet more power to explain the mysteries of life. So let's keep parts of our minds open for that as well. Well, that's just really a scene setter. There are two ways in which quantum mechanics might be important in life. One is in a negative sense, that life, of course, will explore ever more efficient ways of operating, and it could be that quantum mechanics provides a limit to the efficiency of that, that Heisenberg uncertainty frustrates attempts by life to operate with greater fidelity or greater speed or something like that, in which case life might well evolve to the quantum edge, but it can't go beyond that because things become too fuzzy. Alternatively, there could be a positive effect that life or some sort of pre-life, because it's important to understand, we may need to invoke quantum mechanics in the pathway from non-life to life, whatever transformation it was that brought about life in the first place. Life's origin may require harnessing quantum effects. Harnessing is the word. So in other words, instead of quantum mechanics getting in the way, it provides an opportunity for life to enhance its performance. So those are two possibilities. Now I'm going to be talking about the subject of epigenetics, and my central claim is that epigenetics offers many unexplored possibilities for quantum control, regulation, and fine-tuning of biological processes. That's the message. So what is epigenetics? Well, a lot of newspapers give the misleading impression that DNA is somehow a blueprint for an organism. This word blueprint crops up again and again. It is clearly fallacious. You can see it immediately because if you compare our DNA with that of, say, a mouse, it's not a lot different. In fact, I've got this quote here, murine and human genomes qualitatively differ in the structure of any 300 genes. And obviously there are more than 300 ways in which a mouse and a human differ. So that's a sort of trivial example. Another example, if you take, say, a cortical column in the brain, immensely complex. In fact, the figures are, if you take the brain as a whole, human brain has 100 billion neurons and about 100 trillion synapses. So it would be ludicrous to suppose that the wiring diagram of your brain is somehow captured by the information content of DNA. Another example that I like just occurs to me as I'm standing here, that some birds famously navigate by the positions of stars. We're not surely to suppose that if we could sequence the DNA of birds, that somehow we could reconstruct a star map of the sky. It's not going to be contained in there. So all of this type of information comes from somewhere else. Where else does it come from? A clue comes from the developing embryo. So all cells in your body contain the same DNA, and yet these cells are different. So when the embryo starts out, each of the cells is pluripotent and can develop in a variety of different ways into different tissues, kidney cells and brain cells and liver cells and so on, all got the same DNA. And the point is that although they're genetically identical, not all the genes are switched on at the same time. They're not all upregulated, not all operating. And the way in which the embryo develops, with the cells differentiating over time, has to do with which genes are switched on and which genes are switched off. And so the point is that genes can then exist in one of two states, on or off. One way in which you can switch off a gene is to methylate it. The GC bonds in the DNA have a methyl molecule attached to them, and that silences them. And interestingly enough, I'm going to be talking about the work of Stuart Lindsay in a little bit. He's one of my colleagues at Arizona State University. He and his student Parminder discovered just last year the mechanism whereby, and I must just tell you this because it's really neat, the mechanism whereby methylation silences a gene. You might think, well, why? You know, what is it about just sticking these methyl groups on? The discovery was fascinating. Science as it should be done. The student noticed when she was working with methylated DNA and unmethylated DNA in little drops on a Petri dish that they have different shapes. And the upshot of this is that when you methylate the DNA, the bits that are sticking out are hydrophobic, and so they push the water away, and the water pushes back on them. So it acts like soap. And when the DNA is coiled around the nucleosomes in an aqueous environment, as it is in the cells, in effect, the water is pushing down and clamping on these things, and that prevents readout. So it's a purely mechanical process, very, very neat. And it all came from this observation by this young lady about the shapes of the drops. So it's a wonderful story. You can methylate a gene, that's the M, and switch it off. So now, if we have N genes, we can have them in 2 to the power N states. Well, that's 2 to the 20,000, which is a number very much larger than the number of atoms in the universe. So suddenly we go from only 20,000 genes who couldn't possibly explain all the features of the human body in 20,000 bits of information, to now 2 to the 20,000. So now we have a universe, an exponentially large universe full of possibilities. So there no longer is any sort of mystery. So we should think of DNA not so much as a blueprint, but as an algorithm, a way of cranking out, as an embryo develops, for example, this algorithm cranks out the developmental program. We encounter an interesting point here about digital versus analog. So we think of DNA as very much digital information storage, and that's nature went digital 3.5 billion years ago, and that's a very good way of storing information. But epigenetic or epigenomic information, which refers to this higher order of gene switching and gene regulation, epigenetic information can be both digital and analog. How can it be analog? Well, it might, for example, involve chemical gradients or chemical concentrations, which are continuous variables. So it isn't all a digital process. So epigenetics has a large analog feature to it as well. Now, the epigenetic arena, if we might call it that, it's the key thing about epigenetics is you can't pin it down to a particular physical location. With genetics, if you ask the question, where is the genome? Show me the genome. Then a biologist can actually show you a physical object. It's a molecule. It's DNA. But if you say, where is the epigenome? It's distributed throughout the system. So it's a sort of virtual, non-local thing. It's not you can't pin it down anywhere. But if you ask, well, where is the place in which epigenetics does its stuff, then that is the area of chromatin. Now, let me just explain this. Each cell in your body has about that much, a DNA molecule is about that long, and it's got to be all scrunched up to fit inside the cell. And the way in which that happens, the first step is to, as I've explained, the DNA has to wrap around these nucleosomes, and then the nucleosomes have to be compacted into fibers, and those fibers have to be rolled in other ways, and this whole lot of spaghetti gets sort of shoved in inside the nucleus, and it's an extraordinary degree of compactification. Another point here is that at the level of individual DNA, we have a very good understanding of the physics of that. And at the level of the whole chromosomes, you can see them under a light microscope. So we sort of got it pinned down at both ends. But the mesoscopic regime in the middle is a deep mystery. So the late John Widham was an expert on chromatin, and he was fond of saying that you open a textbook and it shows you all these sorts of diagrams, and he said it's all make-believe. At this end, we know, at this end, we know. In the middle, it's complete mystery. That doesn't mean that it requires anything fundamentally new, but it is complex. Here we are. This is the words. Chromatin is a mesoscopic, partially ordered, highly dynamic, nonlinear information-rich medium that lies in the intersection of upward and downward information flows. So it's the chromatin, I should explain, when it's compactified inside the nucleus, if it remains compactified, it can't do anything. It can't be read out. So in order for the readout machinery to get to any of those genes and transcribe them, it's all got to be unraveled. So the whole thing is highly dynamic, unraveling and recompactifying the whole time. And there's all sorts of really complicated dynamics going on. What happens is that instructions from individual genes will flow upwards and help influence the structure, the geometrical architecture of the DNA, but influences from above, from the cellular and even the level of the entire organism, will act in a downward sense, causatively, to affect the structure. So the point I'm trying to get across is that the physical architecture and organization of the chromatin within the nucleus is a key part of how life operates. And this is just a physical process. And so on the one hand, we have information flowing up from below out of the genes affecting this organization. On the other hand, we have physical forces from above. And they come together at the level of chromatin. So if ever you want a domain to explore the possibility of non-trivial quantum effects, it's got to be there among the chromatin. So now I want to turn to how is biological information flow organized? What are the ways in which this can happen? Well, there are many ways. It's not an exhaustive list. First of all, the information is a key concept in biology, and biologists are always using informational-type terms, and one of the terms they use is signaling. Cells signal each other, molecules signal each other. The neural system sends signals around. So we find chemical signals like melatonin and cytokines and morphogenetic gradients that control the way embryos develop. So that's one way in which organisms transmit information. Recently, a lot of excitement about things called exosomes. These are little vesicles enclosed by membranes that contain microRNAs, little bags of microRNAs. They're given out by cells and absorbed by others. So it seems to be some shadow information network going on. Nobody really understands it. So I've given these the term flash drive. So it's like a little memory stick transferring information from one cell to another, or one part of the organism to another. It's another way in which information goes. Then there's mechanotransduction. I was astonished when I first learned about this, that the way in which genes are expressed will depend upon mechanical forces in their environment. For example, if they're subject to shear stresses. We have somebody at ASU, Cheryl Nickerson, and she sends bacteria up into space, puts them on the space station, and the gene expression is different in microgravity from what it is at 1G. So they sense that they're floating or something in orbit. And so the actual mechanical stresses acting and forces, pressure and shear stresses acting on cells can affect the gene expression. It's called mechanotransduction. The mechanistic forces are translated or transduced down to the level of switching genes on and off by processes that are partly understood, not fully understood. So it's a sort of downward causation effect again. There's a lot I can say about that because one of the things I'm involved in is a cancer research program in which we would like to feel that physical forces can be used to control cancer in some way. And it really does look like we're in with a chance because cancer cells, particularly when they're migrating around the body in the metastatic process, are subject to rapidly changing mechanical environment, the shear stresses, for example, in the bloodstream, and when they're clinging onto the wall of a blood vessel and trying to push their way through, very different environments. But the one I want to come on to talk about, because this is a little understood and little known, in fact, aspect of biology, but one I think is really important. I've been convinced of this just in the past few months, and that is the way in which electric fields are part of this information flow story. And I'm referring particularly to the work of Mike Levin at Tufts University, and he does urge me to show you his websites here, so do make a note of that for more information. So I'm reporting on his work, it's not my work, but I've long been fascinated about the hidden electric life of cells, if you like. Now, of course, there are some well-known ways in which electricity and life are connected together, and I'm not thinking about Frankenstein. I'm thinking, for example, of neuronal activity or electric eels, things like that. But it turns out that electric fields are much more pervasive in biology. And here's one of Mike Levin's slides. They're particularly important in developmental biology. So the way in which the embryo develops, I think we're used to the idea of what some people call morphogenetic fields, which are chemical gradients. Lewis Wolpert uncovered this field a generation ago, and Alan Turing did some early work on the idea of diffusing chemicals, controlling the patterning of embryos. Well, it turns out that electric fields also have an organizational function in the developing embryo in a way that can be mapped quite precisely. You can measure these fields and the way in which limbs and even bits of... what am I talking about? Root bits. I don't know what the term is. John Jell will have to help me. Bits that stick out. Anyway. All of this has an electrical story to go with it. Particularly interesting is the story of salamander limbs, because salamanders can famously regenerate their limbs. You chop off a leg and it'll grow a new leg. And the electric fields around the stump, you know, can be mapped. And if you manipulate them, then the leg grows incorrectly. Little snippet of information. If you induce a tumor in a salamander's leg and then chop the leg off through the tumor, when the leg regenerates, if you don't muck around with the electric fields, when the leg regenerates, the tumor is removed. So the ability of regeneration seems to have an inverse correlation with cancer. So there's a clue there. So there's a whole list of ways that Mike Levin has provided where bioelectric signals are important. And here is that list. But basically, the three areas where it's known to be important are wound healing. So if you cut yourself, electric fields around the wound. Organ regeneration. So I mentioned the salamander's limbs. I'm going to give you another example in a moment, an embryo development. So these are all cases where electric fields seem to play a role and not a subordinate role. It seems like by manipulating those electric fields, you can mess up those processes. So here's a couple of examples he's provided me with. One of these is the left-right symmetry breaking, for example, the position of the heart. And if you look at an early stage embryo and map the electric fields there, you can see that this is part of the story. But this one I like in particular, planaria, these little worms you can chop up and then they regenerate themselves. And again, it turns out that there's electric fields around the wound, or the, if you chop through them, the truncated end. And by manipulating those electric fields, you can make them grow two heads like this. This is actually from his experiments, or two tails. I asked him, are these really stupid, these ones? And he said, no, they don't seem any more stupid than the ones with two heads. So clearly then at the level of regeneration and embryo development, these electric fields are going to be important. Now, what's this got to do with quantum mechanics? Well, I'll come on to that in a moment. I've been talking about the organ or organism level, but now at the cellular level, bioelectric signals as well, they control cell proliferation, and differentiation. Apoptosis, that's programmed cell death, migration, important in embryogenesis and in cancer, the shape of cells, so cells have a polarity. And the one I want to talk about is protein transport, and I'm now referring to the work of Bob Gatenby at the Moffitt Cancer Center in Tampa. He's part of this physics and cancer research program I'm involved in, and he's been working both theoretically and experimentally with electric fields within cells, so intracellular electric fields. And he thinks that's a really important part of protein transport, the protein transport story. Now, cells do have an electrical aspect. Across the cell membrane is a potential difference of between 30 and 60 millivolts. Rather larger potential difference across the membranes of mitochondria, up to 200 millivolts. And because these membranes are so narrow, this represents an electric field of staggering proportions, like a million volts per meter. So enormous but highly localized electric fields. I was astonished to learn that you can measure these electric fields quite directly, that there are fluorescent dyes that subject to the Stark effect that you can literally measure at different points inside the shell, the cell, what the electric fields are. So you can actually map out this internal electric system. Now these electric fields are maintained by pumping protons or electrons across the membrane, and so the cell, as long as it's living, is engaged all the time in this type of electrochemical activity, and it does seem to be an absolutely crucial part of the life story. Now, you'll often see diagrams like this, and particularly, again, explanations for cancer, but it doesn't have to be cancer. What you will find is that some sort of molecule, it might be a signaling molecule from elsewhere in the organism, it might be a carcinogen, but it will bind to a receptor on the surface of the cell, and these receptors pass through the membrane. And so by binding something to the surface, this triggers a response inside the cell, normally a very complicated cascade of reactions that will release a protein, a phosphorylated protein, which will then make its way to the nucleus. And you read about all this stuff in textbooks and papers as if it is like a factory production line and everything sort of is in the right place and knows where to go and makes its way straight there. There's always a problem, of course, in biology that because it's a stochastic system, how do the right molecules know where to go? How do they get to the right places at the right time? And so forth. And Gatenby's point is that the electric fields between the membrane and the nucleus are an important way in directing the proteins towards the nucleus. So his hypothesis is that cells use this the intracellular pH gradient and electric field to move the charged proteins from the membrane down towards the inside the nucleus. And these are some of the pictures that you get from the fluorescent dyes where you can track where these proteins are going. And this is a computer simulation showing that if you do a random walk, so you put a blob of proteins here near the cell membrane and then ask how long till they simply diffuse into the nucleus. Well, it's a very long time. But if you do a Coulomb-biased random walk, that is with the electric field, then it's much more rapid. And so the conclusion that he draws is that these intracellular electric fields are playing a really critical role in information transport, in this case, the information contained in the molecule. The signaling molecule that attaches to the cell then has to get that information down into the nucleus to maybe switch on a gene or switch off a gene in response to whatever's happening in the environment. If quantum mechanics then plays a role in epigenetics, and that's the hypothesis, then the electrical story seems like a really good place to start. That is, conductance by tunneling across membranes is something that we should investigate, and that's one area that Johnjoe didn't mention, but I'm mentioning it now as a great place to begin looking. And this is the sort of thing that makes the press sit up and take notice. Cancer, it does seem, is associated with a misregulation or dysregulation of the mitochondrial membrane potential. It's very clear that the electromagnetic potential across mitochondria is very much reduced in cancer because they metabolize in a different way. So is cancer therefore a quantum disease? I don't think I've ever seen anyone use this term, quantum disease. So I'm now going to tell you a little bit about the work of my colleague Stuart Lindsay, which is relevant to this story of quantum conductance in organic molecules. Stuart has developed a very neat technique, which is now licensed, for DNA sequencing involving nanopores. If you take single-stranded DNA and suck it through a little hole like spaghetti, you have a potential difference across the hole, then you can measure the differential conductance current across the different nucleosides, you can do it for both, and you can do that with enough fidelity to be able to actually read off the sequence. And this is now licensed technology, so he's got a great deal of experience at working with this nanopore stuff. So we have, here's the DNA being sucked through the little hole. This is the potential difference across here, the tunneling current. So as each nucleoside enters the gap, then there's about, I think he said, 0.2 volts potential difference across it, and you get a tunneling current, and you can measure that current directly. It's highly localized. It's obviously a quantum mechanical effect, and it leads you to be able to read out the sequence. Now, it's subject to thermal fluctuations, water, contamination, and ions in the vicinity. This is like a little movie if it plays. There we go. That's your thermal fluctuations. There's the water. There are the ions. And there's the contamination. So, you know, it's a mess, but you can untangle the whole thing with enough fidelity to be able to read out the result. So this is called recognition tunneling because the tunneling current has the ability to recognize the particular nucleoside. So you see this has the potential to be a much more rapid means of DNA sequencing. The results, the way in which you interpret the results is a little bit subtle. This is the control where you just have water between the electrodes. Now you drag the DNA through, and you get typical results like this. You get these bursts of current in a complicated way with these spikes like this. And then each particular nucleoside will have a different pattern of noise, a different pattern of those spikes and jiggles. So it can all be averaged out in a way that leads to these different conductances for the four different nucleosides. And here again, we see there's a string of C's, and then here we have AC, ACA, and even can distinguish between methylated and non-methylated nucleosides. And the point I'm trying to get across is that the pattern recognition comes from looking at those spikes there. Let's try and move this along because I'm running out of time. What's going on? Well, the complex remains bound for about a second, and then you get these millisecond spikes, and it's that fingerprint in the noise that is the important thing. The binding strength of the molecule to the system, either side, to the electrodes, in effect, will be very important. If it's strongly bound, then you get a lot more spikes. In other words, it's making better contact with the electrodes. And it doesn't jiggle around too much. If it's a weaker binding, like here, then you have less spikes. It's moving around more, and this is just a sort of stochastic effect. And it's going to be really important for the take-home message. Now, how do you analyze all this? Well, he uses something called the support vector machine. So it's a free downloadable package for data analysis. And you sort of train this thing through a multi-step process and keep feeding it back. And basically what you want it to do is to recognize a noisy fingerprint. And so you keep doing that until you get the fidelity that you need to be able to commercialize the system. And so he's done all that for DNA. And this is typically what you get out of this machine. You can, these different colors here represent the different nucleosides and whether it's methylated or unmethylated. And so it does seem to be a very effective method. But now to bring the story full circle, we conceived a year or so ago of a project we could work on together in which we would apply these techniques to amino acids and peptide chains. The commercial point of view there is that one day we may have single molecule proteomics because unlike with a DNA sequencing where you can use PCR, you can't do that with proteins, and so single molecule proteomics would be a really neat technology to have. And it would depend upon having sufficient fidelity in reading out the tunneling current through the different amino acids that you could have to distinguish them, all 20 of them. So he's begun a series of experiments now, sure enough, we see, again, distinctive spiky fingerprints for each of the amino acids. So he's just briefly showing you these results here. He's divided them up in this way. Of course, we don't have time to dwell on the specific details, but it doesn't matter. The point is that each of these amino acids has its own distinctive signature. Did we get to the end? No, we've got a couple more there. Now I come to the punchline, the lesson of this. It's the lesson of the spikes. Because the key point is, and I think this is going to be true right across quantum biology, the key point is that in biology, fluctuations, noise and fluctuations are everything. They dominate what's going on. They're really important. And in the case of this tunneling current, what happens is, so if you're measuring the, you've got an organic molecule between two electrodes, and it's jiggling around. It's complex configuration. And only from time to time will that configuration be such that you then get a pulse of tunneling current. You get a spike. And unless everything is oriented right, unless you have, as it were, the perfect storm, you don't get much conductance. And so if you were just doing some horrendous calculation, trying to work out what is the conductance through this or that organic molecule, it's going to depend very much on, you know, which bits of the molecule are attached to the electrodes and the vibrational configuration. It's all going to be changing with time. Very, very difficult thing to actually calculate in an aqueous environment as well. You can imagine how complicated it is. And in things of interest here, in this meeting, the complexity just grows and grows and grows. So you think, how will we ever understand something like that? But the point is, whether we understand it or not, there can be, with if you've got fluctuations, a sort of sweet spot or a perfect storm or a particular arrangement in which suddenly you get a very large tunneling current where a millisecond before there was nothing. And so this just shows the possibilities for quantum effects in biology, that as a result of fluctuations, you might find that effects which are normally very strongly suppressed can just briefly have a really important effect. But of course, in biology, because it's full of fluctuations, even something that's just brief and rare can nevertheless still dominate, come to dominate. And that's an important lesson, I think, in biology. In physics, we're not used to that idea of the rare event dominating the outcome. But this seems to be the case in biology. So I've got this phrase here, in biology, noise is good. The project as we conceived it, in case anybody, we were hoping to be funded by Keck, the Keck Foundation. We came very close to that, didn't get the grant. So if someone wants to pick up where we left off, we were working on the hypothesis that there is some non-trivial quantum biology out there, that amino acids with differing electron transport properties might not only permit rapid proteomic sequencing, but that nature will have exploited this in some manner. In other words, that there may be certain peptide motifs which you could discover by going to a library of proteins and discovering whether nature likes certain particular sequences. They may have been selected for by evolution on quantum grounds, on grounds of their quantum efficacy. And there could be many different ways in which peptide sequences would manifest quantum effects in protein folding, for example, their enzymatic function. We're going to hear about that later in the meeting. But in particular, the charge transport efficiency because of the tunneling conductance being such a sensitive function of the peptide, of the amino acid configuration, and hence the peptide sequence. So all of this is for the future. There's a theoretical component. We'd like to be able to identify these motifs by searching libraries to actually do some calculations. You need a supercomputer, but calculate these electron transport properties to see if those spikes can be correctly predicted. And, of course, the elephant in the room of this entire meeting is how to avoid decoherence over sufficiently long periods of time to do anything of biological or biochemical relevance. And I'm sure we're going to be coming back to that. And so that is the shape of the program and some of the experimental work that I think is important.